Notice how it mentions that the people pondered and said, what then will this child become? So in other words, they were very curious. They saw various unusual things related to the birth of John the Baptist. So for example, Zechariah, if you recall, when he goes into the temple, he has this vision. The angel Gabriel comes to him and mentions that he is to conceive, and he finds it hard to believe. He's inside the temple for a long time, inside the Holy of Holies. So when he finally comes out, he's unable to speak because he doubted the message of the angel. So partially because he's in there for so long, and then when he comes out, he can't speak. All of this, you know, people are curious, like, what's going on? Now, he probably wrote down or explained to them what had happened, but then he conceives. So in their old age, Zechariah and Elizabeth conceive, and it's like, this is incredible. This is miraculous. And then when we come to the birth of John the Baptist, well, they don't give him a name that, you know, is part of their family. So they're giving him a new name or a different name, an unusual name, John. It wasn't an uncommon name, but nevertheless, it's kind of unusual. So all of this is kind of, you know, people's curiosity is aroused, like, what's going on? And then when Zechariah writes that his name is John, his mouth is released. He's able to speak once again. So all of these things heighten people's curiosity in regards to John, what indeed will become of this child. You know, it's clear that the hand of God is on this child. So it seems that this child is to become a prophet of God, or some instrument in the hand of God. And when we look at today's first reading from the book of the prophet Malachi, all of this is reiterated to a far greater extent. And the reason for this is because Malachi, even though it's not the very last book in the Old Testament, Malachi was the last prophet of the Jewish people. So for about 500 years, there were no other prophets. And so the people, they had this sense of longing, this sense of expectation. Well, what is coming? But notice this last prophet, and you know, some of the things that is mentioned in today's first reading, it's like it fits perfectly in regards to the coming of Christ. So, see, I am sending my messenger to prepare the way before me. And then it says, the Lord whom you seek will suddenly come to his temple. The Lord himself will come to the temple. God will come to the temple. So Christ, when he's brought into the temple at the purification, if you remember Simeon, right? He kind of marvels and recognizes that he is the Messiah. It's God coming into his own temple. And then it talks about this messenger who will come before the Messiah, who is like a refiner's fire. So when gold and silver are purified, the impurities are removed. So this is what it's talking about. So he is like a refiner's fire and like fuller's soap, and he will sit as a refiner and purifier of silver, and he will purify the descendants of Levi and refine them like gold and silver, until they present offerings to the Lord in righteousness. So he will purify the people. He will have to prepare the people, talking about their sins, the importance of repentance to prepare for the coming of the Lord. And then finally, he will come like the prophet Elijah, which even our Lord uses that reference to John the Baptist. But he will also turn the hearts of parents to their children and the hearts of children to their parents. And isn't that what happens at Christmas? Because of the gift giving, because of the focus on the family, being together, the hearts of parents are turned to children, and the hearts of children are turned more fully to their parents. It's a time when families can come together and enjoy that company. Unfortunately, some people are maybe have no one, but in general, that's what we tend to think of Christmas. And this is exactly what Christ came to accomplish, peace on earth among men, right? So that we don't have any opposition to anyone, that we love everyone, not just parents or parents loving children, but ideally that we love everyone. So this birth of John the Baptist preceding the birth of Christ, as we prepare to celebrate the birth of Christ, is a reminder to us that yes, indeed, he is a great prophet. And as Christ pointed out, he is the greatest of the Old Testament prophets, the most effective in preparing the people and pointing Christ out to them. But his message is one that we need to take to heart at all times, that message of being prepared. And you know, as we get closer and closer to Christmas, you know, especially all you ladies, you're so busy preparing meals and stuff like that. You're at the service of your family, your loved ones, and it's a beautiful thing. But keep in mind that everything that you're doing is also for the Lord. And when we keep that in mind, it just means that all of our efforts, everything that you do for your own family or for the glory of God, is going to benefit you. And so do it with great joy.